This is the Relevant Podcast.
It's episode 1108, and it's the Relevant Podcast here in Orlando. I'm your host, Cameron Strang, and joining me once again from Loverland, Virginia, it's Jesse Carey.
Hello, hello.
From Nashville, Tennessee, artist, producer, mogul, Derek Miner.
What's happening?
Just down the road there, our managing editor, downtown Emily Brown.
Hey, y'all.
And from Los Angeles, California, our newest cast member you know from Social Club Misfits, it's Marty.
Yeah.
No, that's not the one.
Not. We'll work on next week.
You're closer every week, though.
It's bad. I
closer
just went to New York, and that's I heard that, and I thought I could do it. I can't. I don't have the same confidence that they did.
Yeah.
Listeners, you don't know what a treat you're in for on this show. Not only do we have Need to Breathe coming up and great content planned, but Derek Miner is a part of the show because he was supposed to not be because he had a dentist appointment today, and then all of a sudden he just showed up. And
what happened?
Let's hear. Why are you here?
Why are you here?
How is the dentist?
We're listening, Derek. We're ears open.
I'm here because I'm irresponsible and unorganized. That's why I'm here.
Do tell.
That's why we're all here.
Can I ask you if... Yeah.
That's actually precisely. Our tagline.
Derek, can I ask you if this is how it played out? You walked into your dentist's office, went to the front desk, and the moment that you realized that you were there on the wrong day, you just said something like, you know, I just wanted to kind of scope the office, map out the route, so I'm not late on Monday. I notice I go right over there. You guys really should tell me they're doing road work. Good thing I mapped this out.
Is when Michael Scott went to New York for his job interview for the promotion.
Yeah.
And he was there on the wrong day. And he played it off that he was just in the neighborhood.
What was the interaction like, Derek?
Well, I'm sorry to let you all down, but I just checked my calendar. And I looked at it and I said, oh, there's not a dentist appointment here. And I said, well, where is the dentist appointment? And it's on Monday.
So. There you go.
I had a similar experience a few weeks ago. I was so excited all day because I was going to a concert that night and like finished work, got changed, did like put my makeup on, got ready. And then I was like, let me map out where I need to go. And so I pulled up the ticket to see the exact address and I was looking at it and I kept thinking, that's not today's date. It's a full week later. And so I was like fully ready to go to a concert. And then I just ended up staying home and making myself
dinner.
Who was
it? What concert were we going to see? Marilyn Manson, you said? It's Marilyn Manson. Emily loves Taylor Swift and Marilyn Manson. Those are her two favorite.
Those words did not come out of my mouth. No, it's a local artist. Her name's Charlie Adams. She's really cool. So cool. I would highly recommend.
I one time it was when one of the clocks roll forward or back. I can't remember. Either way, I showed up an hour early to church. Mm. Usually it's the hour late, but
and
I showed up an hour early.
You were just
early.
Real holy or something.
And at that point, I had a decision to make, and that decision was either I sit here in the parking lot for a full hour on Sunday morning and then go in, or I go back home, and it kind of counts that I went because my intention was to go.
I'm thinking the same way as you, Jesse. I'm thinking the same thing.
The point, it kind of counts.
Effort was made.
I went, but what I want to say, I got a lot to do today. You know what I mean? Like, I wasn't, I was factoring in this extra hour. It counts that I went. Is it wrong that I went home and counted it?
No, it's not.
No.
It's your fault that the church didn't give you the announcement on their stories. That's the issue.
No. Yeah, that's Derek.
It's also your fault for not looking at your phone or your watch or how did you not know that the time had changed? Like in this day and age.
I can't recall the scenario. I honestly can't. I just know I was an hour early. You know, it might have been a combined service. Either way, I was there an hour early.
You know, in your defense, any daylight savings time, I want it gone.
You need to adjust.
I think it's silly.
You need a day of adjustment.
It makes no point. It makes no sense anymore.
I am a part of the group that wants it abolished. So
now,
every
I will
once
say
in
this.
A while, you'll hear Congress talk about it. Like, ooh, maybe we'll vote to abolish it.
They do it just to, like, tease
us. And then they don't do it.
Just
and it makes
now,
so
I will
bad.
Say
they
this.
Put in a Ukraine defense bill, so now we're never going to get it. Dang
they
it.
Slip it in.
They're always trying to slip it in the wrong things. Dang it. I just want it.
They're earmarking, the new budget.
I have to, I have been on the other end where I show up an hour late, and I'm also like, well, this counts too. So we got a half hour here.
Maybe breakfast.
I gotta be honest. I gotta be honest. Like, I haven't been on time to church. I'm only like two songs late. That's my typical. Mm. It's like I come in on the second song maybe, but I'm never on time. In fact, we were on time a few weeks ago, and my son like made note of like, I don't think I've ever seen the lobby, you know, like before service, because we always just walk through. Yeah. But I am the person who kind of judges, because we always sit in the back. And so like, I see people who come in late. I don't get the people who show up an hour late. Like why come?
Yeah,
there's only like 25 minutes left in the service.
This is the thing. I don't know. Honestly, I don't know.
It's a whole family.
You couldn't have came to my church, because my church growing up, the musicians would be late. Like, we just start singing.
Yeah, but y'all had church for like 4 hours.
Yeah, right? I had church for 4 hours, too. Latin church is crazy.
We start singing. You start singing, and the organ player is playing, and all of a sudden, the drums just enter into the song. Like, you just like, where did it come from? Like, the drummer is coming in. He's adjusting his cymbals. He's tuning his snare while the organ player is playing, and we're singing, and then boom, now it finally rocks. Or the bass player, so all of a sudden you get a bass line on the third chorus. It's like, dang.
Latin people, they came in on time, but it still was 4 hours. The only difference is the musicians afterwards would smoke weed in the parking lot as soon as church, you know, worship was over, and then they'd show back. It was crazy. Everyone was outsourced. That's why. We were just outsourcing. We're outsourcing.
So check this out. I thought that black people went to church a lot, and I thought that black people went to church for a long time, until I rented a studio or a office space above a Latin church.
Yeah, no, it's no joke, man.
And in my mind, I'm thinking to myself,
kind of miss it.
Okay, they're probably on church, you know, let's say Wednesday, Sunday, or whatever. Bro, this church was literally there every day. Yeah. And it wasn't there, kind of there. I'm talking about it was in full
tambourines
force.
Tambourines are out.
Tambourines were out, and it was a small building. So, like, I couldn't record anything. All I heard was speaking in tongues in the back of my rap verses. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, you know what? It's just not going to
work. Anointed.
It's
not the top.
That's the thing about going to like a big evangelical multi-site church, especially where they have like the head pastor kind of hopping around all Sunday morning across town, because they got a hard out.
Yeah, they do.
Each service has a hard out because he's got to be over at the other one. You know what I mean? That's a tight ship, and it's a hard 90 minutes, you know?
Bishop Walker here in Nashville. Bishop Walker preaches 5 times on Sunday.
Oh my goodness. Wow. Good for him. That's amazing.
I grew up AG. And our typical services were 10:30 in the morning until 1. There were 2.5 hour services every Sunday. That was just normal. And if he goes past 1, you're kind of going, you're messing with our lunch. You know what I mean? But now my church is like 1:15 tight.
I love it. What's wrong with it? I like it. I don't like church taking over the whole day.
That's what I'm saying. But like, why were we used to 2.5 hour services in the 90s?
5 hour services. Like Derek, Latin church was like that.
Because we were more holy.
Yeah.
Well, here's what I would say to this. It's the biblical literalist, like the fundamentalists who go all day long. But here's what I would say to them. Go read the Sermon on the Mount out loud, because if you believe this is the word for word what happened, which, you know, that's about 5 to 8 minutes. You can read that whole thing in about 5 to 8 minutes. From the greeting, from him greeting everyone.
Jesus' example of what a sermon is, 8 minutes, a tight eight.
I'm saying his first one.
He didn't fluff. He just got to the point.
Yeah.
I'm saying read his first one out loud and start a clock and see how long. I'm not making any comment about it. I'm just saying that's an observation.
So anything over 8 minutes is unnecessary is what you're saying. So any pastor,
I'm saying it's
un-Christ-like.
I'm not saying anything. All I'm pointing out is we have a scripted sermon and it's not over 40 minutes, much less about 6.
Yeah. I never really had a preference for like if it needed to be a tight 90 or if it could go 3 hours. Like, I've been to churches where it does both. The only time I ever cared was when it was my Sunday to work in the nursery, because I always wanted it to be the 90 minute. Yeah. Like, these kids are screaming, crying. I've already changed them once. Come get your kid. Versus like the churches where they might go a little bit longer and it's like, all of these children are screaming because There's so many of them.
See, our church, they were just screaming.
Yeah, yeah. I was about to say with Derek, exactly. Our kids were in the service, yeah. So they're screaming. It's like an airplane, you know, like we're all on it together. They're behind us screaming. It's bad news.
And then you get it. So imagine this. You're going to church from 9 in the morning to 2 in the evening.
Yeah, that's how it was. 2:30. And then
I'm getting in trouble for falling asleep in church, yeah. And I'm 9 years old. I'm like, yo, why are you mad at me? I don't even know what he's saying. And she's been speaking in a language I've never heard for 30 minutes.
I love when they do like the Benny Hinn thing, and they're like, Pastor Benny, this man had no feet, and now his feet are grown. And like, those were my favorite. Latin church would always have that too. They're like, Pastor, this guy had a missing eye, and now his eye is back. And they do that at the end of the service. So they preach, then they have like miracle hour. I don't know if you've ever had that. Uh-huh. It was like uh-huh. Sunday night. You're like, oh uh-huh. my gosh.
Oh yeah, the pastor was sitting in the front, and then you come up and
tell
get prayer,
testimonies and stuff. They fall out and they use a blue blanket and they cover the girls. They cover uh-huh, with a big
you
blanket.
Put the modesty cloth.
A little olive oil. Why not? You know.
I will say, I feel like a lot of churches have gone to the TED Talk sweet spot. You're about 20 minutes. 20 minutes. You do the little illustration. You know, you cite some Malcolm Gladwell study. You tie a couple Bible verses in, you're out. Like, that is the formula that a lot of them do now. Just straight up TED Talk.
AG is like on the money. You're in and out, hour and a half. You're going to get great worship, great sermon. And you know what? You're headed to Cane's, you know, to get some chicken. The end.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I go to a charismatic church now, AG? Still, and
no, it's non-denom. But the great worship, announcements, and a full sermon, and we're in and out in hour 15.
Moves quick.
So I'm like, what were we doing for 2.5 hours?
Worship, that's why announcements. The egos.
There's always a special song. I remember that. Our service was so long that like kids were in it for the worship, and then they dismiss to go to kids' church like at the middle point of the service, and because kids' church was still an hour and a half. Like, who's preaching that long? Anyway,
I just know my stepdad took a lot of smoke breaks. And you know, we were Pentecostal, so it wasn't like Baptist. Baptist, you were allowed to smoke. Pentecostal, it wasn't no smoking. So it's like he's back behind a building smoking for he was struggling, man. We were all struggling.
Yeah, we were all struggling.
Emily, you grew up Baptist. What was your service experience? Because we all. I would assume is different than what you had.
I will be honest. I am shocked to hear that Baptists can smoke because that was not my Baptist church.
I miss those long services, Derek. Oh, I miss them. I miss the 4 hours.
I mean, unless they were smoking, I shouldn't notice it.
I guess it's a certain type of Baptist because, you know, Martin Luther King was Baptist.
Yeah,
and
they do cigars. All my Reformed friends, like, that's like a point of the religion, like they use to like make people want to join. Hey, you could do cigars. I'm like, I don't smoke cigars, but all my Reformed guys are like, Martin Luther, he smokes cigars. I'm like, okay, I don't know. But that's like a selling point of the religion. You could smoke a cigar once now and then and have some whiskey if you're there. It's crazy. I grew up charismatic. I could not do anything. I was not allowed the house until I was 21.
Yeah, fact.
That's how I was.
Fact. Yeah. My stepdad's family literally said that going to the movies was a sin.
Oh, it's rough.
Oh.
Wow.
That's old school AG Pentecostal. That's my parents' upbringing.
Pokemon were
my mom still doesn't go to movie theaters. My aunt only went to a movie for the first time about 10 years ago, and she's in her 80s.
Road Trip with Tom Green.
It was like one of those Christian movies, like Soundproof or Bulletproof, whatever, Fireproof. Yeah, it was one of those things. She went with her church, and like it was a big deal that Rosella
would be the best movie for her to see for the first time.
What if it was Avengers?
That's what exactly like I was, Derek. I was thinking that. I was like, what would be the best first movie for someone to see? It'd probably be,
John Wick
3. Just in the middle of it.
She's going to Fireproof, and she went in the wrong theater because she didn't know how it worked.
Jesus is out here killing everybody.
She's like, geez,
she's like she went to the first thing that was playing, Hangover 2, believe it or not. Hangover 2. She loved it. Didn't really understand the message, but.
I love how we're all scarred by church.
But we're not scarred.
We all have our own story of, oh my God, this service was long, it was short. We all have like a little story. I love it.
I just can't figure out as an adult now, how, like, we have a full service. Like, I don't, how did it take twice as long every week?
You cut the fat, bro.
They have a lot of songs.
We used to sing like eight songs.
That's true.
Like,
worship has gone smaller for sure. Worship has definitely gone smaller.
Mm-hmm. Worship has turned. Yeah.
Well, the other thing, too, like, I grew up in a church that, like, vamping alone would add probably 40 minutes. Like, we sang that verse like seven times. Like, we're circling. Like, when you think a song is ending, boy, it is just getting started. You wait. They will take a 4-minute song and stretch that out to 15.
If they're singing Shout
20.
To the Lord, oh God, it's a wrap. Shout to the, they get like, they pump themselves up with momentum. Shout to the, it just keeps getting crazy. Shout to the Lord. It's bad. It's bad.
And then we're singing Donald Lawrence songs, so there's like 4 modulations.
That's a 7-minute song.
Take it up.
They start testifying in the middle of the song. It's like minute 5.
Yes, it's awful.
You see, when
Donald
I was young,
Lawrence had us in church for about 20 gosh. Minutes of song.
You start
bro,
telling
no
a story
lie.
In the middle of it.
Well,
when I was young, the Lord told me.
At some point, though, a lot of churches figured out, it was like a warning track in baseball, like when you're getting close to the fence, like the texture changes, so you know it's, you know, the warning track for hey, don't worry, guys, we're wrapping soon, is the keyboard player starts tinkling a little during the sermon. That means you're gonna be out of here in about 5 minutes.
Did you guys memorize like the language of the band when they're like, wrap it up? You know, they're doing one of those, like, you just, I'm like, yeah, he's doing the hand thing. Like, they're just wrapping it up. You know, that was my favorite.
Now, see, it's different for us because if the keyboard player or the organ player started playing, you got about 45 more minutes because that means the pastor about to ramp up. You start throwing music behind up. Like, no lie, there was pastors that would not preach unless you had an organ player at the crib. And they had to be able to go to dun, 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 dun. Blah, blah, blah. They got to be able to play the parts that would ramp the crowd up.
Good.
Like, if you couldn't do that.
I want to go to church
here.
Right now.
Out of here, fam.
See, we have 3 services in the morning, and the first one's an hour, and the middle one that we go to is an hour and a half, and then you got the final service. The final service,
I love
ended.
That one.
You know what I mean? So like that,
I'll go to that.
To me, we're already starting at 12:30. I ain't going open ended on. My pastor's amazing; he'll go open ended. You know what I mean? But they trimmed the first one down to an hour because I asked them what they cut out because I'm not going to the early service. They said they cut out the announcements, so they do that one to be shorter. But we're an hour and a half. But because there's back to back. I don't think
they're warming up the crowd. You know, they warm up the crowd. They warm up the crowd announcements. Ladies, where are my ladies at? That's 10 minutes. Ladies, all right, we got a women's meeting next Friday. You know, that alone is 10 minutes per announcement.
Right. And but because we have 3 services, there's a monitor in the back of the auditorium with the countdown clock.
It's in red.
Cohen. My kid like keeps his eye on that clock and he's like elbow me, damn, pastor's going over. It's like 2 minutes over. Look at that, you know, like, dude, we didn't have a countdown clock when I was growing up. You need to. So now we sit where
my church has that too now, and I don't think they've ever stuck to the time. And that's fine. I don't mind it, but I'm always like, oh, we definitely already hit that. And it's like we just started the first verse of a new song, so we're gonna be here for a few more minutes.
I'll tell you what could shave off some time is these motion graphics packages that now play before sermons and announcements. Like the men's retreat, I got a montage in like 3D graphics that look like we're playing. It's you know, preempting Sunday night football. It's like, dude, this could have been handled just on the website.
Could have been
like, you know, the church is employing a motion graphics artist that does like just big dramatic sermon intro like packages. You know, and then men's retreat announcements stuff.
My church is like an hour, like Mosaic in LA. We're about like an hour and like 20 minutes the most. But the worship is, it's just pure worship, pure message, pure altar call. Get out of our building. We have another sermon coming. You know, like there are 5 services. Like you gotta go. Go, go, go. Like they let you go out one way while everyone's going in through a different way. It's like, you know, when you go to Tower of Terror and they're like, all right, you need to get out because we have more people coming in. Uh-huh. That's kind of the vibe.
Like I said, we have a great show in store for you. Need to Breathe is coming up. We also have your feedback at the end of the show. But stay tuned. Right now, up next, it's Relevant Buzz.
Nothing but the gold. this is Cohen Strang. Right after they recorded this episode, my dad actually lost his voice, which means he can't record the transitions, and I get to tell you all the song names and introduce the guests. So with that said, you're listening to Two Door Cinema Club. The song is Sure Enough.
Okay, it's time for
Relevant Buzz.
All right, tell us what's happening at the intersection of faith and culture this week, Emily.
Yeah, we got some super exciting news. Nate Bargatze, one of our favorite comedians, is starting his own family-friendly content company.
Oh, wow. What's he going to be doing?
So it's called the Nateland Company, and he shared that he's just starting something to feature a lot of comedic content, like stand-up comedy specials, sketches, scripted content for film and TV, podcasts, music, lots of different things. And the first thing is he's dropping a series that will be available on YouTube, just highlighting a lot of up-and-coming comics that are
again,
family-friendly, which is not always a big genre in the comedy world.
It is unusual for a clean comic to be as funny as he is. He is that man.
Well, Gaffigan and Seinfeld works clean. You know?
That's true. But I don't know that they're uproariously funny. Nate is uproariously funny.
Yeah. There's definitely clean comedians, but yeah, I think to be as big as they are, and it seems like while you can find them, there's not as many. So I'm excited to see kind of he's in the world. So he gets to bring in like, hey, I know these guys and they're funny and you should like kind of lift them up.
He's going to be doing scripted stuff too. They like for TV and all that you said.
Yeah. Yeah. They're working on a lot of different projects.
Mm-hmm. Good for Nate, man. Yeah. That dude went from obscurity to being one of the biggest, if not the biggest comic working right now. Maybe Hart is bigger.
It's crazy.
Oh, yeah. This guy is hilarious. I love this guy. Oh, I see him on TikTok all the time. He's blowing up.
And we had him on the pod years and years ago, right after Cameron, you and I saw him at a South By comedy showcase or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Ever since then, I got to see him recently and chatted with him a little bit after. And I think he is like surprised as anyone as of like this, like, wow, you know, it's just how big he's gotten. But he's never really changed. He's always kind of stuck to the same routine. It's almost like culture caught up to him a little bit, because I feel like there was so many people just got burned out of like, all right, here we go, some sizzling take about cancel culture or whatever, you know what I mean, where it's like it's not exhausting comedy to listen to. It's just like self-deprecating everyday situational comedy, which there's always an appetite for. Like, trends change when it comes to, you know, social issues or politics or whatever. You know, I'm not saying that stuff doesn't have a place in comedy, but Nate Bargatze is funny because it's just relatable, self-deprecating,
he's hilarious,
like, everyday stuff. You know?
You're never going to lose as a comedian if you're never going to run out of material if you're with making fun of yourself.
And that's all he does is make fun of himself. You know, it's like Seinfeld.
His beard made him look more like a superstar, in my opinion, because you look at like him without the beard. And like, okay, things were good. But when he had that beard, things changed for him. I really believe it. It's like Jack Harlow. The beard changed everything.
The beard did it.
Look at him as a little baby. Look at him now. It's different. It's different. That guy's hilarious.
My parents, they also became Christian when I was born. And everybody's still Christian. But I got them when they were the most Christian. I had 80s and 90s Christian parents. Well, that's the most Christian you can ever get of the Christian. I think Jesus had more fun than I did. I was not allowed to watch anything. I mean, when they made The Simpsons, it was like, I guess they're just showing R-rated TV shows now.
All right, what else is happening?
Switching gears a bit, we do have to talk about a report that was released by the U.S. Department of Education this week. Liberty University.
Education in the United States. Yes.
Yeah. Well, this might not go where you think it is. Liberty University has been accused of fostering a culture of fear and silence around reporting sexual violence within its campus community.
It's not good when the government is calling you out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for the several years now, some different things have been coming to light that survivors of sexual assault at Liberty have shared that they faced kind of further harassment or just dismissal from university officials when they went to report what had happened to them. And in 2021, survivors actually filed a lawsuit against Liberty that was then settled in 2022. But this year, the Department of Education began investigating whether Liberty complied with the Clery Act, which is a federal law mandating the reporting of crimes that occur on campus. So they've been talking with officials, both high and low. And it's still an ongoing investigation, but they've released a report of what they found so far. And they've determined that Liberty did not comply with this act. And in fact, multiple officials, including a former university president and senior administrator, were part of the leadership to help keep sexual assault quiet on campus. It's a very messy situation. Again, it's still ongoing. They're still looking into it. But, you know, just these findings alone are obviously a cause for concern.
Is this from like the staff, or is it just any sexual situations that have happened on the campus from like student with the student, staff with student? Like, is any specifics as far as
it doesn't
matter, but I guess right. I'm trying to understand the logic
why cover it up?
Yeah.
Why hide it? Like,
and the university did respond. Again, they can't talk about it too much because the investigation's still going on, but the current president, Don DeCostin, has said that they are committed to ensuring compliance is met. So they didn't, some people are trying to read between the lines and saying, you know, he's not denying that it happened, but he's also not affirming that this is what happened. He's just saying right now we are committed to doing the right thing moving forward. So yeah, Liberty's had a...
Yeah, they had a couple... I'm like trying to figure out when's the last time I heard about them.
What happened?
I'm like, yeah. It was the boat situation. Boatgate, right?
Really?
Do you guys remember Boatgate?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, I know. Cameron's going to cut this if I start talking about it. So let's just move on. He's already cut 30 minutes out the last episode. I heard it.
Blackwater Jerry.
Pool Boy Gate?
Blackwater
Jerry.
Okay. We unfortunately had a...
Are you serious?
We kind of helped break that night when that photo got posted of him and his pants undone with the woman that wasn't his wife and all that stuff.
Did you guys have legal
recourse? Yeah, we posted that the next morning. Like,
I remember losing... We had an ad deal fall through, a substantial one. I recall
Liberty used to be a big advertiser. And then we kind of called out this behavior seems very strange.
Our defense, it wasn't on us.
Yeah. No, Liberty's still one of the top 10 largest universities in the country, private schools.
I love a lot of the musicians that I work with come from Liberty. I mean, like Enzo, Derek, you know Enzo, a lot of these guys that come from Liberty, all of them, a lot of these, like eight of the Christian artists, like eight of them, they all came from Liberty and they're all so talented. So,
yeah. Yeah, a lot of good designers have come out of Liberty. Like, we've hired, I mean, it's...
Didn't CC Top come from Liberty?
Yes,
they did.
I used to go to basketball camp there. The best basketball camp fight I ever saw. And I saw numerous ones, and it was at Liberty University. It was great.
They got hands over there?
It was great, huh? It was open-handed, which made it like... It wasn't like a lot of pushing and shoving. It was five slaps. Pop, 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 pop. I couldn't believe it. There's nothing more disrespectful.
A man slapped another man?
Seeing several open-handed slaps. And the other guy couldn't move. He was seated, and he was just stunned. Just stunned. There's nothing more disrespectful than an open-handed slap, much less five in rapid succession. It was great. That's my favorite Liberty. Pop, 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 pop. And the guy's sitting there like,
did he hit? Did he slap him back? Did it turn into a little slap fight, tickle fight?
No. People pulled him off. The people who weren't laughing, you know.
All right. What's the last thing? What else do you have?
We're going to end it on fun light note.
Please.
Maverick City Music is coming out with a new album at the end of the month. But today, they're dropping a new single from the album called Yet. So here's a clip of it.
Here it is.
Yeah. That was Yet from their upcoming album, The Maverick Way, which
the
will
Maverick
be out
Way.
October 27th.
Not the Jesus Way, the Maverick Way.
Cam had to say something.
See, just Cam, saying. You being a hater, bro.
Just saying. Just saying.
They should call it the Way Way. Right. You know, he is the way. This is there the way, go, way Way.
All right. There you go. Check it out. And they're going on a tour. They announced a tour, too, at the end of the month.
Hillsong brought songs, like worship songs, back to like 3 minutes. And then Maverick was like, nah, we're going to go back to 6 and 7 minute songs. So if we have to blame like long church services, might be Maverick now.
That's a short.
Upper Room. You ever seen Upper Room? 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
20. I love them. They're my favorite. Upper Room's my favorite.
Oh, they 20 have a minutes. Minutes
like,
on.
The whole drive is one song.
They're like the Grateful Dead of worship artists. They just kind of noodle around for a while. You know, they're like the jam band. Like if they brought, you know how like Grateful Dead brought out John Mayer so he could like noodle around on songs for like 15 minutes. It's the same thing. You could see Upper Room doing that with like Phil Keaggy. You know what I mean? Just like we're just kind of making it up. So just do whatever, man.
All right, that'll do it for
Relevant Buzz.
Stay tuned. Up next, Need to Breathe joins us.
I need a lot. I don't know a lot, but I know enough to follow. God brought me from the days when I would move for dollars. Still hard to trust when I see the plan is hollow. When it comes to prayers, God, I know I need a lot. Yeah. I need a lot. When it comes to courage, I need a lot. When it comes to faith, I need a lot. When it come to grace, I need a lot.
You're listening to YB. The song is A Lot. Our guest today is Bear Reinhardt from Need to Breathe. They recently released their newest album, Caves. Emily talked to Bear about his favorite songs in the album, the artists that inspired them, and more. Here's part of that conversation.
Are there any songs in the album that you're like specifically excited for people to hear?
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot. Honestly, I really do genuinely love the record, which I don't say every time. I think there's a song, Temporary Tears, on the record that really it feels like I could have written it when I first started. I think you learn a lot about the craft of songwriting and in some ways it gets streamlined. You know, it's like songs become more about the structure than the actual thing. And that song is like that. Like it, I remember playing the demo to the band and them being like, I don't know, maybe it's okay. I don't, you know, it's just, it's an emotion more than anything. And the way it turned out when we all kind of put our weight into it and then had Foy Vance thing on it. I'm just incredibly, it's just a moving song to me. I would play it, you know, at my funeral in that way. So I'm excited about that. Dreams is, it will be the big focus track when the record comes out. It's the song I wrote with Judah from Judah and the Lion. And he's been a buddy of mine for a long time. And I've kind of watched their career as they've been coming up. And he told me a story. He called me one night. He's like, we're going on tour. Maybe we should write a song. I was like, yeah, definitely. You know, and he goes, I have this story that you probably don't know. When I was 16 or 17, he saw us at Cannery Ballroom in Nashville. And he was like, I literally went home and was like, I'm going to make a band now.
Wow.
And so that kind of blew me away. You know what I mean? It's something that I've known him for a long time. I didn't know that. And he was like, what if we wrote a song about how it's kind of a dream that I'm getting to go on tour with you? And I was like, whoa, that's heavy, you know, but humbling and awesome and all those things. So we wrote a song really thankful to both of our audiences. I think that's something that like any band needs a lot of grace. And if they've made 9 albums, you get lost along the way a lot of times. You make tons of mistakes. Both of us have incredibly loyal fan bases that really care about the records that we make and live their lives to them. And so that, you know, the line in the chorus is, fools like us are only here to prove that you make dreams come true. And it's really kind of that. It's like, I can't believe we're in this big band. We're like, we're both rock stars. And how did this even happen? You know, like it feels ridiculous to us in a lot of ways, but we're so thankful for it.
That's why I brace myself every minute, trying to hold on tight for a good ride. Fools like us are only to prove you make dreams come true. You make dreams come true.
That is really cool, and like just like a really cool like full circle moment for both of y'all to be able to have that. Out of curiosity, was there like an artist or a band that inspired you to get started in music?
Yeah, there were several for sure. The biggest inspiration of these people, I think it's funny when I say, but like I was playing music. I was in college. I was playing more like, I was into like Toad the Wet Sprocket and all this like acoustic-y kind of college music at the time, you know? And I went to see a buddy of mine asked me to go, and I honestly didn't know. I knew like a couple songs, and it was the Black Crowes.
Okay.
And they were on this record called By Your Side, which is like, you know, just a straight rock record, like not a lot of songs, just like rock and roll. And I had never seen a real rock and roll band, and you don't see many anymore, to be honest. And I just literally the next day I went and bought an electric guitar. I was like, I think this is what I want to do. I think, and that still is an inspiration to us. It's something the band listens to backstage, and of like their live records and things like that. The swag and sort of commitment to the old school rock and roll thing is still awesome to me. I think that, and there was a lot. I mean, obviously Switchfoot was the band that we saw that was like, we're like, maybe we could do this, you know? Especially the first couple of records where I was in high school, and it was like, you know, it was actually musically intricate. Those records were like the bass playing on the records. I thought Tim was like insanely underrated as a bass player, and the melodic value that he added. So we would like break apart those records, and then, you know, and then I would say Arcade Fire is probably our number one influence in terms of, especially like Neon Bible, that sort of time is probably what we bring up for like the visceral response those records have, and how over the top and dramatic, like I joke, that's like almost Meatloafish kind of like, you know, immediacy, you know, like that, I think we bring that up in the studio a lot.
Interesting. I love all of those bands, so it's very interesting to see that like those are the ones that like inspired you. The Black Crowes, was that the first concert you'd been to, or what was the first one?
No, I unfortunately had been to see Carmen when I was a kid.
Was that your first concert? Was Carmen?
Probably. Which you know, went without not wanting to go. It was one of those things. I mean, we were like, you know, my dad was a preacher. They were very conservative. They're not now, but they were then, in terms of like, you can only listen to Christian music. It was like a very, and we had this one little Christian bookstore in our town that had demo tapes in it, you know? Mm-hmm. And so like, if I can only listen to this, I'm going to go try to figure out the stuff that's like, you know, the coolest to me. And I would just spend hours in there after school listening with the little headphones on. And, you know, it was stuff like Tourniquet and all these like, Even there was like a really cool alternative time with Christian music where like Prayer Chain and 77s, all of that kind of stuff was like, it actually was really great music at the time. There wasn't a market for it. So it was kind of like uniquely its own thing. A lot of that stuff was very influential. So I saw shows like that, you know, early on. Probably one of the first. I did see James Taylor when I was in high school. My dad took me because I learned to play guitar, and that blew my mind. I mean, in the way that you're like, I could never do what that guy does. Like that is so high level that it's unattainable. Black Crowes felt a little bit more like, maybe we could do this.
Yeah. Tie me up, hold me down. In a cage, there's no one locked. Leave them all big enough that the phones fall out the socks. But you still see me crowding ends and knees coming out.
That was Need to Breathe. Make sure to check out their newest album, Caves. It's out now, and stay tuned. Up next, it's your feedback. You're listening to Cherry Glazer. The song is Bad Habit.
All right, it's time for your feedback. Last week, we asked you, what are some of the most memorable and or awkward things you've witnessed in public? What were we talking about that prompted this?
Jesse watched someone get kicked out of a Little League game.
Yes. Oh, yeah, that's right. The walk of shame.
Welcome to Little League. Oh, it's great. Welcome people were still to Little League. Guys, people were still talking about it on this Saturday. Like, it was,
we were still excited about that. Do you have any Little League updates that we need to know about?
Oh, I mean, we could do a whole separate pod on, you know, people getting yelled at for smoking in too close proximity to the dugout, though. Like I said, the big talk of the league was still how you should have seen the umpire walk in this Saturday. Like, he knew everyone was talking, like, that's the guy right there, chest out, like, oh yeah, don't mess with him. He will shame you in front of everyone. He won't just kick you out. He'll say something awesome on your way out, like an action movie star. You know what I mean? Like, it was like a Schwarzenegger.
You need to make him a shirt.
Yeah.
You need to make him a shirt that says, like, welcome to Little League.
It's like in Commando where Schwarzenegger like kills the guy on the plane and he puts the blanket over him and the flight attendant goes by, he's like, my friend's just taking a nap. That basically was his action movie, you know, finishing line. It was fantastic.
Forgive me for not knowing, but like there's a real movie called Commando. Isn't going commando meaning like you're going pantsless? Well,
this was the 80s.
The Arnold Schwarzenegger Commando? Yes, I love that movie.
When somebody's going commando, it's because they're pantsless.
But
no.
This was before that.
Commando he was an actual commando in the city blowing stuff up with bazookas. I don't remember a lot. I just remember he had a bazooka. And did he shoot it in the mall or something? Like, it was like something crazy, bro. Like,
there was a lot of mall takeovers.
Peak Arnold Schwarzenegger, bro. Like, this. This is top of the line.
How did the phrase "go in commando" the movie turn at the into very what
end.
It is?
If I'm just kidding, no, it's not true. That never happened at the end.
No,
that's what I was saying. Did something happen in that movie that made this a phrase? Anyway, all right. You hit us up on Twitter/X at Relevant Podcast and told us some of your most awkward things you've seen. Here's a few of our favorites.
Jeff Gentry said he was recently at a wedding where the bride's dad got up to make a toast and evidently had clearly taken advantage of the open bar. She said after 10 minutes, his daughter finally got up and took the mic from him. 10 minutes is I'm telling you, two minutes is a long toast. And I don't know, if you watch the clock, like 30 seconds, like, is wrap it up. Okay, we get the idea.
Yeah.
10 minutes is pretty unbelievable. I would have... The best wedding toast I ever saw was literally, it was the best man, and you could tell he overthought it, because he brought out a homemade sock puppet halfway through and started having a conversation and had a whole ventriloquism routine. That was maybe 5-10 is a very long time.
Jesse, I remember the wedding in Portland that you helped MC the reception for.
It's fantastic. Yeah,
it was great. You were very funny. Do you remember though when the friends and family took over and started doing the toast? They went,
they were butchering it.
It was, you know, like 2 hours. It felt like
I was trying to work that room. I was warm. they killed the vibe in the whole room.
I know you could work a room like that, Jesse. Honestly, like, it's all personality.
He was great.
They killed the whole vibe. The whole vibe.
My buddy, totally killed my best friend, he's Nigerian, and his family's like super cool, but he married a girl. She's awesome. And her family's very like religious, super religious. So I did the toast and I was making fun of like Latin people and nobody, it was just like 100 people doing this, like really upsetting me. So I know that I was like, I love being married to a Latin woman. It's worth every bullet in my car. The Nigerian people started laughing. The Nigerian people were like, ha, 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 ha. And then the Mexican family on the side was like, doing one of these. And so I was like, let me wrap it up before the cartel kills me. Okay, just want to say I love everybody. Let's get out of here and let's leave. It was like that.
If the person doing the toast starts doing crowd work and just starts pointing at random cousins, that's when you're like, okay, this is going to get ugly.
This guy knows. I don't know what that is.
Right. I don't know what you're talking about.
The worst thing about this wedding was it was like, you know, people were partaking. And I don't think that they had a clear plan of who was going to toast. It was kind of like, if you feel led to come say something, blessing the couple, come on up, grab a mic. Mm. And people were loose it was very much at the end of the night, and it was just like people kept coming up. It was just like, stop.
That's why church was four hours long.
Yes, exactly. Pastor Benny, this guy had one eye.
For us, it was different. My sister was on crack, and she's not on crack no more.
That was also what they were saying at this wedding. It was really weird.
There was one guy who had come up with, and he had like a laptop, and we're like, oh boy, here we go. And he had hung up, and he put up like a slideshow, and the slideshow was like Bitmoji, like And you could tell within about the first 90 seconds, it was getting zero laughs. And it was like, no, he's committed. He's doing it. He prepared a whole slideshow thing. Yeah. And it was pure pain the whole time. And I'm someone who loves cringe, but this was pure pain.
Yeah. All right. There's a few more.
Karen Daniels said she used to work at a retail store, and she said, I'll never forget the man who accidentally knocked over four mannequins in the store. I've never seen someone leave a store so quickly. That's tough. Like, you cannot recover from that in any way.
Do stores still use mannequins? I'm trying to think.
I assume he probably just tripped and fell. But it's like, you know, they're all standing close together. Like, all the mannequins are close together. So it's like,
like dominoes. Yeah. Like,
believe it or not. Okay, so actually, I went to the mall for the first time in Florida this weekend. And Florida malls they're empty. And then when you go to California, the malls are packed. The mall culture is still alive in the West Coast. So, like, it's exciting to go to the mall still. It's just like that. But over here on the East Coast, I don't feel like malls are
using it. It's outlet stores out here for us, I think.
We have an interesting dynamic because we have so many visitors, right? We have 75 million visitors to our city. And so, like, the malls that are down on the southern half of the city are packed, booming, and it's all tourists. And literally, like, and the outlet malls and the malls, like, there'll be a lot of tourists from South America that literally bring luggage with them to the mall because it's cheaper for them to fly to Orlando, do all their shopping, and then load it up and fly back than it is to buy those things in Argentina or wherever.
Is it just because of the tax?
Right. No, they sell suitcases in the mall too. There's suitcase stores. You just buy it there, then go to it. Yeah.
So our malls are packed. Our malls are packed too, but it's all international tourists. Right? Yeah, Millennia, Florida Mall, like all the.
I used to work there at Nordstrom.
Are you serious?
It was rough. Yeah, so when I worked at Nordstrom, I worked for Nordstrom for 10 years. And so I was in HR. I was started becoming like a higher up. And so I would have to go to different stores. And going to Orlando was like the toughest situation. Always packed, so many people. But whoever worked there, people never returned. So if you worked there, you would cash out because people would take off the tags and stuff and then throw it in the bag, right? Throw it into the suitcase and they're out. They're never going to see you again. So you sell like 10 grand with one person and you made that money and they're not going to return it. The difference being in Miami when they're going to wear the outfit and then return it on Monday after they wore it three times. It's just different culture.
Exactly.
The Miami girl wore the outfit and then wore the shoes to the club and then, you know, got mustard all over her outfit. I don't know how, because she had a hot dog after the club and then returned it on Monday. It was rough. It was just different.
Yeah, I had a homie that would put tape on the bottom of their shoe. Like
to return it.
At the club?
So the bottom of the shoe had tape on it. Yeah, bottom of the shoe had tape on it.
Yeah, they call it gum shoe. You can collect the dollar bills when you're walking through.
No, what kind of club are you at?
Get like $400. Oh, not that kind of club. Oh, I'm sorry, guys. I'm from Miami. This is my mind.
All right. Well, there's more where that came from. If you want to check them out, go look at our replies over on X. Okay, it's time for this week's
editorial question of the week.
Well, at the beginning of the show, we were talking a lot about our church experiences growing up and kind of how it's so different now. Church seems to be so different now. And that, looking back, there's a lot of weird, not weird per se, but I mean, just like, you know, we took things as normal that we now see
quirky
as unusual.
Stuff. A lot of
so we want to know your church quirk experience, like something that your church did growing up that you now are like, huh? Hit us up on Twitter at Relevant Podcast and anywhere else you see us post the question on social, and we'll read our favorites on next week's show. Church quirk. I remember one time I visited a storefront charismatic church, literally a storefront. It was like a strip mall and sat in the back and didn't like it at all. And I had earrings at the time. So the guy held the altar call for the clearly unsaved guy on the back row who's visiting the church for the first time. You know what I'm saying? Like, held the altar call for me. Obviously, I didn't budge.
You was a target, bro.
I know, right?
Anybody new is a target, too. In Latin church or storefront, I feel like whoever's new is the target.
Yeah.
Because there's only a few people who are new.
Church gets out. I'm beelining into my car. Like, a guy literally comes running after me and told me that during service, the Lord gave him a word for me. And that if I come back next week, he'll be released to give it to me. So he was trying to manipulate me.
Wow, manipulator.
Hey, he hit you with the Lord of the Rings.
That's like a sales tactic.
Yeah. He's like, yeah. So come back next week, he'll be released to give it to
me. That boy hit you with a Dragon Ball Z.
I love that word, released. I'll be released to get. I have a good prophecy story. I went to church one time, and this lady... At the time, I just started doing music, so I think that it was exciting. You know, I was a part of the church and doing music, and people were excited. So this lady, I don't know who she was, but she grabbed a mic, and she said, just like Abraham separated the Red Sea, God's going to separate the Red Sea. And she's saying in front of a microphone, like 400 people. Man. And then at the middle of it, she's like, Moses separated the Red Sea. Oops, saith the Lord, Moses separated the Red Sea, and that's what she said. And the Red Sea and Moses. So she like correct. She's like, God corrected himself in that prophecy. She's like, oops, saith the Lord. It was Moses who separated the Red Sea, and that's you know. And so we're all like, I'm like, I don't think this is gonna happen for me. I'm pretty sure my career is gonna be in the dumps now. It's over. Everything's over for me. This is gonna hurt.
Before we wrap up this episode, we want to thank Need to Breathe for being with us today. Make sure to check out their new album, Caves, and look for more of that conversation over at relevantmagazine.com. Speaking of the website, my dad wrote a bunch of stuff, but basically just go to the site a lot, sign up for Relevant Plus, and follow Relevant on social media. Okay, on that note, we'll wrap things up.
I'm Cameron Strang.
I'm Jesse Carey.
I'm Emily Brown.
I'm Derek Miner.
I'm Marty.
Thanks for listening to The Relevant Podcast. Check out our features, interviews, and news updates every day at relevantmagazine.com. And make sure to follow Relevant on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for the latest. For more great podcasts, browse the shows on the Relevant Podcast Network, which you can find at our site. And while you're there, don't miss the all-new era of Relevant Magazine. A new issue releases every other month at relevantmagazine.com.
I have been on the other end where I show up an hour late, and I'm also like, well, this counts too.
Relevant Podcast Network.